From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Jason Steinhauer, and I'm a program specialist at the John W. Kluge Center at the Library of Congress. Before we begin today's program, please take a moment to check your cell phones and other electronic devices, and please set them to silent. I'll also make you aware that this afternoon's program is being filmed for placement on our website, as well as our YouTube and iTunes playlists. I encourage you to visit our website, loc.gov/Kluge, K-L-U-G-E, to view other lectures delivered by current and past Kluge Center scholars. Today's lecture is presented by the John W. Kluge Center at the Library of Congress. The Kluge Center is a vibrant scholar center on Capitol Hill that brings together scholars and researchers from around the world to stimulate and energize one another, to distill wisdom from the library's rich resources, and to interact with policymakers and the public. The center offers opportunities for senior scholars, postdoctoral fellows, and PhD candidates to conduct research in the Library of Congress collections. We also offer free public lectures, conferences, symposia, and other programs, and we administer the Kluge Prize, which recognizes lifetime achievement in the study of humanity, and which we will award in 2015 this fall. For more information about these and other events, please sign our email list on the way out or visit our website, loc.gov/Kluge. Today's lecture is titled Publicity, Celebrity, Fashion, Photographing Edna St. Vincent Millay. Our speaker is Sarah Parker, now concluding her tenure as an Arts and Humanities Research Council Fellow at the Library of Congress. Sarah's research focuses on the poet and playwright Edna St. Vincent Millay, a celebrated American writer and winner of the Pulitzer Prize for Poetry in 1923. Her research draws on the Edna St. Vincent Millay papers held in the Library of Congress Manuscripts Division. These papers include correspondence, diaries, notebooks, photographs, scrapbooks, and family papers relating to Millay's life, family, and literary career, including her daily life at her steepletop farm in Austerlitz, New York. And incidentally, I received a call from Austerlitz, New York this morning. The Millay House there wishes that they could join us, and they invite you all to visit them at their facility in Austerlitz. In her talk today, Sarah will discuss photographic representations of Millay and show how Millay consciously used her public image to promote her career and to subtly subvert expectations surrounding the poetess. A word about the fellowship that Sarah holds. This is a truly wonderful partnership between the Arts and Humanities Research Council of the United Kingdom and the Library of Congress. The program allows early career scholars funded by the AHRC to undertake short-term research here at the Kluge Center. Since the inception of this partnership, the center has welcomed more than 200 scholars from British universities funded either by the Arts and Humanities Research Council or the Economic and Social Sciences Research Council. It has enriched the scholarly and intellectual life of the center and the library, and for this collaboration, we are very grateful. Dr. Sarah Parker is an Impact Research Fellow at University of Stirling in Scotland. She is the author of The Lesbian Muse and Poetic Identity, 1889 to 1930, and her other publications include Fashioning Michael Field, Michael Field and Late Victorian Dress Culture, an article in the Journal of Victorian Culture, Whose Muse, Sappho, Swinburne, and Amy Lowell, in Algernon Charles Swinburne, Unofficial Laureate, and A Girl's Love, Lord Alfred Douglas as Homoerotic Muse in the Poetry of Olive Custance, Women Cultural Review. She is currently working on her second monograph entitled Picturing the Poetess, Women Poets, Celebrity, and Photography, and this is the subject of her research, which brings her to the Kluge Center. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Sarah Parker.
Thank you, and I just wanted to begin by thanking the Kluge Center, the AHRC and the Library of Congress itself. It's been such a stimulating environment for this project. Also a shout out to prints and photographs, particularly, who have been so helpful with my work and whose collections I'll be showcasing in this talk. Also to add that if you can't see one of these screens, then do move now, because photographs are going to be quite important in this talk. And can everyone hear me as well? Okay, good. So, in March 1928, the Ladies' Home Journal featured a quiz entitled, "Can You Name These Modern Poets?" accompanied by photographs of the poets featured. One of these was Edna St. Vincent Millay, one of the most famous women poets of the 20th century. To a considerable degree, this fame was due to the circulation of her photographic image. Millay was not simply a celebrated poet, she was a mass media celebrity whose image appeared in countless publications, including newspapers, literary journals, and magazines. She was photographed by the most celebrated photographers of her day, including Arnold Genter, Man Ray, Herman Mishkin, Carl Van Vechten, and Bernice Abbott. So, in this talk today, I want to focus on these photographic representations, asking what they mean in terms of wider constructions of poetic identity. So what do we expect a poet to look like? Who qualifies as a poet is what I mean by poetic identity. Ideas of gender and wider literary and aesthetic culture of the early 20th century. And I'm going to discuss these images in a fairly chronological order and identify the various personas and phases of Millay. By looking at Millay in relation to modernist aesthetics, the 19th century poetess, fashion history, gender, and performance, I aim to trace the myriad ways in which Millay used photography to construct a flexible and changeable poetic identity. Paying attention to her photographic representations enables us to unpack the mythology of Millay and to trace the construction of an iconic celebrity poet whose self-fashioning and performance style continue to influence later 20th century women poets. So, as some of you will know, Millay's career began with a poem. In 1912, when she was 19, Millay entered a poetry competition in the Lyric Year. Her long poem, Renaissance, didn't win the competition, but was included in a published volume that emerged along with the winning entries. And it was quickly agreed that Renaissance was, in fact, the best poem in the book. And speculation about the author, E. Vincent Millay, grew. And, for example, the poet Arthur Fickey wrote to Millay that, so not knowing her identity, wrote to her that no sweet young thing of 20 ever ended a poem precisely where this one ends. It takes a brawny male of 45 to do that. So a short bio was published with Renaissance saying that this was by a young girl, but Fickey wouldn't believe that. And Millay replied in characteristic style, "I simply will not be a brawny male. Not that I have an aversion to brawny males, au contraire, but I cling to my femininity." And she signs off, "P.S. The brawny male sends his picture. I have to laugh." So this anecdote shows that even at an early stage in her career, Millay was aware of the complex relationship between her gender and her poetic vocation. And she's proud to prove that she is not a brawny male. And she uses her photograph to flirtatiously invite further admiration from Fickey that will turn out to be useful to her later career. And she used a similar tactic to pique the interest of the Lyric Year's editor, Ferdinand Earle. So she sent him a playful physical description that reads, "You would perhaps be interested to know that I have red hair, am 5'4" in height, and weigh just 100 pounds. And she sends this along with a photograph, which he actually asked to keep. So, at the same time, though, Arthur Fickey's assumption that a sweet young thing of 20 cannot write such powerful poetry, of course, suggests that at the very cusp of her career, Millay was going to have to contend with and manage expectations surrounding gender and ideas about poetic ability. So the Association of Women with the Muse, which is something that I've worked on in previous projects, was an ongoing challenge that was faced by women poets, well, really throughout history, but I've particularly focused on the idea of the muse in the 19th century. And this is really summarised as the assumption that women inspire poetry, but they don't necessarily write it themselves. So women are the muse, but not the poet. And through being photographed, a woman poet risked further becoming enshrined in ideas that she was an object rather than a subject. But nevertheless, a number of canny women poets, both in the 19th and 20th century, began to work out strategies for negotiating this dilemma by forging a visible professional identity, self-fashioning as a woman of letters, for example, and exerting control over their image. So their image might circulate and turn them into this object, but they were at least going to have some control over what kind of object they were going to be, the object moving towards being a self-fashioning subject in her own right. And this really relates to the wider study that I'm currently working on, where I'm looking at numerous examples of women poets self-fashioning across the 19th and into the early 20th century. So Millay, like her 19th century foremothers, realised that her photographic image did have the potential to entrap her in narrow stereotypes of the woman poet as muse, but it could also be used to her advantage in order to publicise her work. Millay's celebrated poem eventually led her to go to Vassar in 1913, and it was during this time that her most famous photograph was taken. So in the spring of 1914, Millay was invited to visit her publisher Mitchell Kennelly's country estate in Mamaroneck, New York. Here she is photographed by Arnold Genter, who was famous for capturing celebrities such as Isadora Duncan and Greta Garbo, and for documenting the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. So Millay was photographed by Genter, as you can see, standing beneath the blossoms of a magnolia tree, her face averted, her fingers brushing the lower branches. And this was the image that launched Millay's career. In Nancy Milford's words, becoming, quote, the blaze that marked an era in American poetry as her own. So why did Genter's photograph serve as such an iconic image of the poetess at this time? Firstly, because it resonates with some key aesthetic preoccupations of the early 20th century, including Orientalism, paganism, and Hellenism. Genter spent his early career photographing San Francisco's old Chinatown, and apparently he cropped out English language signs and non-Chinese people in order to make his images look more authentic and to tie in with ideas to do with Orientalism. And I think we can see traces of this Orientalism quite subtly in Genter's photograph of Millay. So the delicate blooms and interlaced branches of the magnolia tree resemble the cherry blossom, an important symbol in Japanese art. And I thought when I was writing this, I can't tell people in DC about what the cherry blossom means, you know. Such symbolism also links the young Millay to the favoured Orientalist trend in modernist poetry at this time. So several 20th century poets were inspired by the brevity and symbolism of the Japanese haiku, for example. In April 1913, Arthur Fickey himself sent Millay his book, 12 Japanese Painters, a volume inspired by the ukiyo-e school of artists. In the same year, Ezra Pound composed one of the most famous haiku of all, In the Station of the Metro. So Genter's image of Millay resonates with such imagery drawn from ukiyo-e. It captures the mood of ukiyo-e too, which has been characterised as capturing delicacy, sorrow, and a sense of transient beauty. Genter's image also suggests the new freedoms of the female body in the early 20th century, which is epitomised by dancers such as Isadora Duncan, Loie Fuller, and Martha Graham. So Duncan was a key figure within both modernism and feminism, and she suggested new possibilities for the female body at this time. So according to Elizabeth Francis, quote, Duncan's dances were events through which her viewers recognized themselves as modern. They were also shocking. because Duncan performed the female body differently in a period when the transformation of womanhood was both a source of anxiety and a central element of radical theories of liberation. So in this sense, Duncan's work in dance resembles Millay's work in poetry at this time. Millay's lyrics, particularly those published in A Few Figs from Thistles of 1920, equally sought to capture the new and the modern, the fleeting life of the city, of late night parties, of multiple lovers. And these poems shocked as much as they delighted in their frank expression of subjects previously thought unsuitable for women writers, such as free love, promiscuity, active female sexual desire, and the pleasures of roaming the city. So when we compare Genter's photograph of Millay to his images of Duncan and her dance troupe, we can observe some of the striking parallels between them. So, for example, in this image, Genter photographs one of Duncan's dancers beneath a tree, her arms upraised towards the branches, implying a kind of pagan nature worship, and also, I think, a kind of erotic nature worship as well. And such New Age ideas were linked by the Greenwich villagers to free love. So embracing nature also meant embracing the body, and that meant embracing bodily pleasures beyond the cultural strictures placed upon them, such as marriage and monogamy. And as the fashion historian Deborah Saville has shown, such bohemian ideas were often expressed and embodied through dress. So Duncan was particularly inspired by ancient Greek dress. And this is Duncan herself in the collection. So as you can see in Genter's photographs, she often wears a draped Greek robe or toga or chiton. Not sure how to say that one. So though Millay is dressed more conservatively in Genter's photograph, I think we can see a similarity in their bound hairstyles, which are remarkably similar. And Duncan writes about wearing her hair rolled and coiled in a loose knot at the nape of her neck, in a Hellenic style, which she bound with a fillet or Greek headband. So Genter's images of Millay and Duncan recall similar photographs of the modernist poet H.D., or Hilda Doolittle, who was photographed in Greek guise. So such Greek images confirmed H.D.'s reputation as the modern Sappho. And in his review of H.D.'s book Heliodora, Louis Untermeyer characterised H.D. as, quote, a wood nymph lost in modernity, a Greek marble faintly flushed with life, a delightful but detached anachronism. So I propose that Genter is trying to project a similar image of Millay in his photograph by portraying her as an ethereal dryad wandering in the forest. But although this image, the Genter image, promotes the idea that we have just happened upon this nymph-like poetess, Millay was in fact highly conscious of the role that she was adopting here. So I want us to focus on Millay's outfit in the photograph, a simple button-down linen smock with a white collar. Millay had recently purchased this outfit from Wanamaker's department store in New York and was eager to wear it, writing to her family, quote, I have paid $10.50 for a tan linen, tailor, cutie, so becoming with a white muslin collar, spring dress that I really need to wear to college. So the tone here is playful, as Millay's letters tend to be. But I think it's significant that she purchases this dress knowing just how cutie she will look in it. And the emphasized so becoming reads like a sarcastic version of the rhetoric of a fashion magazine, such as Vanity Fair, in which Millay's work and image would later frequently appear. So the illusion of artlessness cultivated by this dress in Genter's photograph is complicated when we learn of Millay's ironic self-awareness, this sense that we get in her letters home. So youthful, minimalist, cute, this outfit is nonetheless a carefully planned costume. Millay is shrewder than she looks in Genter's image. She knows there are benefits to playing the ingenue. And this self-awareness is later clear to see in Millay's writings for Vanity Fair. So from 1919 onwards, Millay began to write short pieces under the pseudonym of Nancy Boyd. Millay's Boyd pieces often take a satirical look at the events and images that shaped her own career. So in one Boyd piece, she writes, Why is it that the girls of so many of our best families, the hope of our land, as you might say, insist upon getting all safety pinned up in several yards of mosquito netting and standing about somebody's golf links while Arnold Genter takes their photograph? So here you can see how Millay is sending up her own by then iconic photograph, turning Kennelly's estate into somebody's golf links and referencing her own ethereal pose as unpoetically standing about. And the mosquito netting is an interesting detail, as Millay did in fact wear mosquito netting as a veil when marrying Eugen Bossevane in July 1923. So she actually then goes on to fulfill her own ironic prophecy there. So Millay was clearly aware that the artifices employed to create the appearance of ethereality, which was necessary to the poetess image demanded by the public, were often absurd in reality. So elsewhere, Millay includes a portrait of herself spied by Nancy Boyd, so she's writing as Nancy Boyd, but seeing Edna St. Vincent Millay, in a cafe, quote, eating an enormous plate of sauerkraut and sausages, which Boyd declares was such a shock. I had always imagined her so ethereal. So here Millay delights in deflating mythology surrounding the disembodied, delicate woman poet by indulging in an ironic parody of her own celebrity persona. Millay's self-awareness to the point of self-dissection is also apparent in her unpublished self-portrait poem, which was written in the spring of 1920. So Millay and her friends John Peel Bishop and Edmund Wilson challenged one another each evening to compose self-portrait poems. This is Millay's, and I haven't included it on the slide because I think it would be too small to see, so I'll just read it to you. Hair which she still devoutly trusts is red. Colourless eyes employing a childish wonder to which they have no statistic title. A large mouth lascivious, aestheticised by blasphemies. A long throat which will someday be strangled. Thin arms in the summertime leopard with freckles. A small body, unexclamatory, but which, were it the fashion to wear no clothes, would be as well dressed as any. So whilst this description asserts a subtle confidence in the value of this small body, which would be as well dressed as any, naked, there are also darker undertones to the description. So as Cheryl Walker, the critic who's done some very interesting work on Millay, if you want to pursue reading more, Cheryl Walker notes that the reference to strangling here hints at violence directed towards the female body, and that there is something in her words, quote, disturbingly clinical about Millay's description, as though her body were part of a department store inventory. So this itemizing blazon in the poem contributes to this sense as it moves downwards, listing the hair, the eyes, the mouth. And if you see it on the page, it's in this very slender line, as if Millay had chopped herself into little pieces and was offering them up to the reader's gaze one by one. Millay's self-portrait poem echoes a letter to her family, written after being photographed by Genter a second time, and unfortunately the photographs from this session have been lost. I hope to discover them somewhere one day. So she writes, besides having beautiful hair, an extraordinary good forehead in spite of the freckles, an impudent, aggressive and critical nose, and a mysterious mouth, I have artistically and even technically an unusually beautiful throat. So here Millay views herself with detachment. She notes her flaws. She assigns characteristics to her features and adopts a criteria that defines her throat as both artistically and technically beautiful, whatever that means. The vulnerability of the throat on which Genter chose to focus on this occasion, Millay writes that Genter made me lean forward and lift back my head and photographed my throat. The vulnerability of her throat recalls her suggestion that she might be strangled in the self-portrait poem. And I found this image, which shows Millay, this was photographed by Eugen in one of their home albums, but you can see that she often liked to show off her amazing throat. So Millay's throat is quite literally Genter's target here. And media accounts of Millay's readings also repeatedly focus on her throat. So this is, of course, the traditional locus of the lyric voice, but it is also significantly a site of vulnerability, suggesting the potential, and in perhaps the fetishization of the potential for that voice to be strangled or stifled. As her self-description shows, Millay was enthusiastically complicit in marketing her various parts. Her sense of being a product for sale was further intensified by the location of her work and image in fashion magazines. We can therefore see how Millay became adept at viewing herself as a product, assessing her various selling points and emphasizing them in her representations. In this sense, she is an ideal figure for demonstrating the art critic John Berger's assertion that, quote, women watch themselves being looked at. This determines not only most relations between men and women, but also the relation of women to themselves. The surveyor of woman in herself is male, the surveyed female. Thus, she turns herself into an object, and most particularly an object of vision, a sight. So from her early experiences of the sensation surrounding the Genta photograph, Millay learnt to commodify her image, becoming an expert at turning herself into a sight. And as her celebrity grew, she became increasingly conscious of the role her image played in promoting her poetry, and she adapted that image according to the demands of the changing market. So I now want to move on to a crucial aspect of Millay's appearance, which is what Millay wore. As the it girl of 1920s America, Millay's sartorial decisions embodied Greenwich Village bohemianism. Her bobbed hair marked her out as a new woman and associated her with the flapper image that took hold in the 1920s. She owned dresses by Paul Poiret and Mariano Fortuny, and I've included some examples here, both of whom were popular designers for the New York avant-garde. Breaking away from the corseted, restricted designs of the late 19th century, the designers took inspiration from antique and Eastern designs with an emphasis on drapery, freedom of movement, and wide kimono-inspired shapes. And in the middle there, you've got Duncan's daughters, or members of her troupe, who are in Fortuny gowns as well. So Millay was exceedingly fond of the kimono particularly. And for example, in October 1920, Millay requests that her friend Witta Binner, who was going traveling, quote, bring me whatever is the Chinese equivalent for kimono, and you mustn't neglect it until you get back here, and then try to fool me with some batiked dish toweling from Vantine's. This is the Vantine's catalogue, Vantine's was a shop in New York which sold imported Oriental goods. So Millay's letter suggests that although her tastes were indeed in line with Greenwich Village fashion crazes, she sought to distinguish herself by the authenticity and quality of her garments. She was not going to accept goods from Vantine's. And we can observe some of these Oriental influences when looking at Millay's dress and shoes, which are held in the Smithsonian. So you can see the intricate beading on the slippers and the gold embroidery of the silk caftan verify Millay's commitment to artistic dress, linking her to artistic and aesthetic dress crazes of the later 19th century and to, as I say, Greenwich Village bohemianism. As early as 1917, Millay realised the impact that clothing could have on her audience, and she writes to her family of attending a reading for the wealthy Mrs. Hooker and her guests. My trunk hadn't come, and so she dressed me up in something of hers, a gown with a train and hanging about 6 inches on the floor all around, made out of 3 rainbow-coloured scarves. And family, I discover I have nothing to give readings in. I must have long dresses, trailing ones. The short ones won't do. If Norma hasn't done anything with the green chiffon and rose scarf, then that dress ought to be made up very long and drapey, more like a negligee than a dress, really, very graceful and floaty. That was what I wanted for this talk, but unfortunately unobtainable. So the impact of Millay's dramatic dress is described in accounts of her live readings that she gave throughout her career, and I have been reading hundreds and hundreds of these in the library. Over and over again, the same things are said, but here's a couple of examples. So a report from her 1925 reading at Bowdoin College in Maine states that she wore a robe of gold and bronze and green, and her voice was a bronze bell as she read. Back and forth she moved by terms grave and gay, pompous and flippant. Her robe, because it was traced with gold threads woven into its pattern, whispered and chimed faintly against the floor. If Miss Millay had not been a poet, she could easily have been an actress. And elsewhere, the Boston Sunday Globe reported, I think this is of the same reading, she wore a loose flowing gown of gold and bronze without the semblance of a girdle. Her sleeves bound at the wrist no larger than a ring flared above the elbow. But what is the use of trying to describe the way her gown fell to the top of her gold slippers and her trick of flicking the train out back of her? So, as these accounts suggest, on stage, Millay channeled the persona of the poetess as priestess, chiefly through her wardrobe of dramatic costumes. Millay was consistently referred to as a poetess, so I should say I use the term throughout, you know, consciously, or a girl poet sometimes, but mostly a poetess, girl or a girl poetess. So this was a term that raised certain expectations in her audience. A poetess was expected to be delicate, enchanting, and above all, feminine. Continuing a tradition of popular 19th century poetesses, such as Letitia Elizabeth Landon, or L.E.L., Felicia Hemans, and Frances Sargent Osgood, all of whom were associated with domesticity, sentimentality, and romantic effusion. So through her dramatic costumes and theatrical use of her body and voice, Millay sought to embody the poetess in her live performances. Unfortunately, this led her body itself to be collapsed with her poetic work. So one reviewer stated that, quote, Millay's poems are as well turned as her own slim ankle. Just as Millay's work was associated with her physical appearance, her poems were often interpreted as personal revelations coming from the woman herself. And in this sense, Alyssa Zellinger has argued that Millay elicited a similar response to her earlier 19th century foremothers, whose poetry was also frequently understood as providing public access to their inner private emotions. And this poetess tradition takes its inspiration from Sappho of ancient Greece, the first woman poet, famed for her lesbianism, particularly nowadays, but who, in another myth, eventually committed suicide due to unrequited love for the fisherman Phaon. So Sappho is repeatedly depicted in paintings and other artistic works, performing her last song on the cliffs before jumping to her death. And so her poetry is therefore inextricably associated with the display of her body. And this image of the dramatic improvisatrice is developed in Madame de Stael's Corinne, which imagines the woman poet as a captivating public performer. And here she is dressed up as her own character in this painting by V.G. Le Brun. So this imitation of Sappho, as we can see here in this painting, went beyond poetry and into the realms of self-fashioning. So, for example, the 19th century poetess L.E.L. dressed up in Sapphic costume and wore her hair a la Sappho, although I've never even been able to figure out quite what sort of hairstyle that would be. Felicia Hemans was also aware of the pressure to play up to the poetess image, writing to one of her friends, quote, "If I were in higher spirits, I should be very strongly tempted to do something very strange amongst them in order to fulfil the ideas I imagine they entertain of that altogether foreign monster, a poetess." So Hemans's wry comments, to me, anticipate Millay's jest about the need to wrap oneself in mosquito netting in order to fulfil what is expected of the unconventional poetess. And like Hemans, Millay chafed under the pressure of her own popularity, complaining of feeling like a prostitute at one heavily attended public reading. So this sense of sexualized self-exposure can be traced in the work of many earlier 19th century women poets who often conceptualized their literary fame as a kind of dangerous denudation before the public gaze. But such self-exposure was, at least in Millay's case, also part of a carefully constructed performance. And it's worth remembering that, so you remember that reviewer saying if she hadn't been a poet, she could have been an actress. Well, in fact, she was an actress as well as a poet. So Millay had performed in plays at Vassar. She'd written plays for the Provincetown Players and collaborated with them. And here is one delightful still that I came across from her in a play called The Bonds of Interest in 1919. And this is her performing in a pageant at Vassar. Sorry, this one's a bit blurry. So taking her inspiration from the theatre and from her own acting career, clothes for Millay were really more akin to costume, and her apparently spontaneous gestures and off-the-cuff remarks during readings were often rehearsed and repeated at the next public reading. So this is what I've come across in my work, that the reviews across, you know, across America, she's doing the same things and saying the same things, and they're constantly delighted at what they think is this fairly spontaneous performance, but it's clearly not. And we can see this, for example, in the readings that I've quoted to you, the reference to the dramatic sweep of her robe and the trick of flicking her train behind her. So that reviewer clearly can see that this is a constructed gesture. And Millay's clothes, of course, played a crucial role in this performance. They were her props, creating a distance from the everyday self and projecting an image of the iconic poetess guaranteed to hold her audience spellbound. Sandra Gilbert and Susan Gubar, in a very interesting piece on Millay, describe her as a female-female impersonator. Although conscious of femininity as a masquerade, she nonetheless manipulated its conventions in order to forge a public poetic identity. Through her performance of hyperfemininity, Millay simultaneously draws on and interrogates the tradition of the 19th century poetess. And in her live readings, she dramatizes the poetess's authenticity, rendering it theatrical in the process. And her choice of clothing was crucial to this demonstration. Her capes and sweeping robes cultivate the aura of the poetess while revealing that identity to be a performance. But in their emphasis on Millay as female-female impersonator, however, Gilbert and Gubar overlook a significant facet of Millay's self-presentation. She also played with masculinity. So this is Vassar again. So in 1915, while at Vassar, Millay played the role of the young poet Marchbanks in George Bernard Shaw's Candida. And she wrote to her family, quote, "I felt perfectly at home in the clothes. People told me I reminded them of their brothers, the way I walked around and slung my legs over the arms of chairs, etc. Somebody thought I was really a boy." So in this final section of the talk, I now want to explore the construction of female masculinity in Millay's later photographic images, an androgynous persona that has been overlooked by critics and biographers. And I think that's perhaps because it undermines that early image of the feminine ingenue which launched Millay's career and which is so well known. So as mentioned already, Millay clearly enjoyed dressing up, viewing clothes as theatrical playthings that enabled her to adopt various and flexible identities. However, though these roles were often markedly feminine, Millay also experimented with more masculine personas. So, for example, and hopefully you can see this one, during a trip to Albania in 1921, Millay was photographed in traditional Albanian dress, including trousers that she describes in a lot of detail on the back of the photograph. And this image is strikingly similar to the portrait of Lord Byron by Thomas Phillips. And Millay was often compared to Byron in the press. And indeed, they share some similarities, a high level of celebrity being one of those, and of course, the scandalous love life that fascinated the press of their respective times. They were also clearly not averse to co-opting exotic cultural identities in order to increase their mystique and sex appeal. And I think that's what they're both doing here. So through donning Byron's Albanian dress, Millay adopts two layers of otherness. So she's playing with both gender and ethnicity here. And in doing so, she signals her affinities with this sexual outlaw, Lord Byron, whose rumoured bisexuality echoed her own risque public image. So Millay continued to play with masculine identities in her photographs of the later 1920s and the 1930s. So in portraits by Herman Mishkin, Carl Van Vechten, and Bernice Abbott. So in all of these, I call these the suit and tie portraits. So in all of these, Millay wears a smart suit jacket, a shirt and a tie, her hair is cropped, and in Mishkin's portraits particularly, I'll just go back to that one, she appears strikingly androgynous. So Millay was not alone in cultivating female masculinity during the 1920s and the 1930s, and Bernice Abbott's photographs in particular chronicle the expatriate community of female artists, writers and journalists in Paris who often dressed in starkly masculine fashions and wore their hair short. So this is Abbott's photograph of Jane Heap, Thelma Wood, Be Still My Beating Heart, Sylvia Beach, and Princess Eugenie Murat. So the style and bearing of these women is simultaneously an expression of artistic freedom, a hallmark of modernity, and a subtle signifier of lesbian and or bisexual identity. And as Terry Wiseman notes, writing about these photographs, these sitters are, quote, framed by their own terms of definition. They take control of the camera's gaze, particularly in Murat's photograph, as you can see here. She's just really staring down the viewer there. And it's worth noting that Abbott's images arose naturally from her sitters. They wore their own clothes, and they were not posed by Abbott. So they really were very much in control of the process and in collaboration with Abbott. Evidence from the archives suggests that Abbott photographed Millay on at least two different occasions, 1929 and 1940. And a letter that I have discovered here in the archive reveals that Abbott herself proposed the first photo shoot and that she and Millay had a closer relationship than has been suggested by biographers. So on February the 11th, 1929, when Abbott was considering a return to New York and setting up a photographic studio there, she writes to Millay, "Dear Edna, I have just seen Margot Schuller, and in the course of our conversation, we were discussing yourself, herself, myself, photography, etc., which brings me to the point of such a proposition. I hope you remember me from the hectic days of New York and Paris, and at least a few beautiful dances we have had together." So Margot Schuller, mentioned here, was one of Millay's lovers. And so what we can see Abbott doing here, I think, is building on a network of same-sex attachments between women in order to gain a prominent client for her business. And there's also a hint of desire there on Abbott's part too. So she's reminding Millay of the beautiful dances that they had together in Paris in order to arouse her interest and kind of seduce her into agreeing to the photo shoot. And Paris was, of course, a well-known venue for exploring female same-sex desire during the 1920s. And Millay participated in that world enthusiastically, befriending the society hostess, Natalie Barney, and the painter, Romaine Brooks, who you can see here, painted both by Brooks. And so she attended Barney's famous lesbian salon in Paris. So like Abbott's photographs, Brooks's paintings also chronicle the lesbian world of Paris in the 1920s and 1930s and frequently portray women who exhibit strikingly masculine styles. But as Laura Doane has noted in her very interesting book, Fashioning Sapphism, masculine dress was indeed actually just very fashionable across the board in the 1920s. So, for example, in 1924, the Daily Express in the UK praised the ultra-masculine cut of the latest tailor-made suits for women and the, quote, mannish high white collar of stiff but exquisitely fine white linen. So as Doane observes, this vogue for masculinity enabled figures such as Radcliffe Hall, famous for The Well of Loneliness, and Una Troubridge to covertly express gender ambiguity and lesbian identity while also being the very height of fashion in their times. And I would suggest that a similar dual meaning also permeates Millay's suit and tie portraits. I mean, these images are reproduced in the press at the time. You know, these are the popular images of Millay at that point. And so on one level, we can read Millay's tailored clothing and suit and tie as simply chic. But looking at this alongside her well-documented bisexuality, this also lends a further significance to her androgynous portrayal. And in this sense, Millay's masculine persona, signified by her nickname Vincent, which was what most of her family and friends referred to her by, and embodied in her androgynous photographs of the 1930s, can be read as a covert yet knowing expression of her sexuality. And as Nikki Hallett notes, and this is in a discussion of Romain Brooks's paintings, actually, but I feel it's applicable to Millay here too, the adoption of masculine styles by lesbian and bisexual women need not play into pejorative stereotypes of gender inversion, so the idea that same-sex desire came from having a male soul and a female body, but may instead reflect a playful, self-aware and self-critical engagement with such stereotypes. So Hallett writes, Brooks portrays the lesbian use of the cliché, so the fact that lesbians did often choose such sartorial style is itself part of the subject and the artistic play with ideas of self-realisation. The lesbian subject is already part of her own self-reference. As an agent, she has already engaged with dominant modes of self-expression and has chosen to appropriate them, subvert them, or ignore them. So I think we can reinterpret Abbott's photographs of Millay in light of these observations. So these images set up a scenario whereby the sitter, Millay, and the photographer, Abbott, participate in playing with clichés and signifiers of lesbian identity at the time. But despite the prevalence of these images, Millay's androgynous persona is often overlooked. It is played down by the interviewers in the 1930s, for example, who still insist on portraying Millay as a fragile young thing and describe her as a girl in nearly every interview. Journalists might play down Millay's androgyny because it is potentially threatening, especially when combined with her childless status, which was also frequently mentioned by journalists, her open marriage, and really it was a fairly open secret that Eugen was fine with Millay doing exactly what she wanted, and her formidable career success, which of course outshone her husband. And age is also a factor here. So in contrast to the boyish ingenue, Millay could no longer really be categorised as a girl, simply playing with boyishness. So her masculinity as a masculine mature woman had some more troubling implications that interviewers and journalists might have wanted to play down. And this downplaying of Millay's female masculinity is not confined to the early 20th century. So in the 2001 biography by Daniel Mark Epstein, he finds Millay's 1930s photographs threatening to the point of dismissing them entirely. He writes, there are hundreds of photographs of Millay. The most widely known and reprinted are the most misleading, from the severe Mishkin portraits of the 20s, where Vincent in pageboy, gentleman's coat and necktie looks like Rupert Brooke needing a haircut, to the most awful and enshrined of all, the last Bernice Abbott portrait of Vincent. This was not, nor was it ever, Edna St. Vincent Millay. So Epstein goes on to speculate that Millay chose to be portrayed, and this is in his words, as a nun, a librarian, or a lady lawyer, because she did not want to run the risk of appearing too alluring in public and attracting attention to her sexually adventurous personal life. But for me, this contradicts Millay's other publicity strategies. As we have seen, sensual femininity was something that she projected in other press photographs and that she actively sought to embody in her live performances. And any scandal surrounding her personal life was probably actually more likely to increase her appeal and mystique for the public. That's what she was known for from the days of A Few Figs from Thistles. Epstein concludes that Millay would not have written her celebrated sonnets if she had not been so attractive. Quote, if she had looked like Edith Sitwell, Edith Wharton, or any other Edith, sorry to any Ediths out there, if she had resembled Amy Lowell or Emily Dickinson, if she had not had the effect on men that she had, she would not have written the sonnets that are now under discussion. So the fact that such opinions were published in 2001 underlines the uncomfortable relationship between women writers' appearance and their later reception. So put in basic terms, I think that a glamorous image may help a woman poet to survive into posterity, albeit in a limited way, so as a beautiful muse or as a romantic icon, while less appealing images of that same poet may be suppressed as not true to this idealization. And in this context, photographic images become effectively a battleground of interpretation. So Epstein's disavowal of Millay's androgynous persona reads like an anxious attempt to ward off queer interpretations of her life and work, to enshrine her as the sexy muse of a series of discerning male admirers. But the problematic nature of Epstein's comments aside, his observations are correct in one sense. He's right that along with Genta's portrait, the androgynous photographs of Millay are among the most frequently reproduced, even if biographers and critics are curiously silent about them. So a disjunction opens up here between the ethereal girl poet portrayed by Genta, Millay's floaty persona in her dramatic public readings, and the austerity of her dress and bearing in these later photographic images. Why did Millay play the poetess in performance and the androgynous poet in her later photographs? Was she expecting and negotiating a different audience for these images than for the audience for her public readings? Or was this simply a new phase of Millay? And I think that we can perhaps look at Millay's business-like look as a way of negotiating aging. So by the 1930s, Millay knew that she could no longer play the ingenue, and so instead projected a more professionalized image. Cheryl Walker has recognized that aging provided a real challenge for Millay, and she compares her to Madonna in her insistence that, quote, her body was somehow independent from the frames in which others sought to bind its significance. But Walker concludes that Millay's strategies were ultimately unsuccessful, citing Jean Untermeyer's unflattering description of Millay in 1942. Her hair, which she wore in a long pageboy cut, was now shades lighter than the red gold locks of her girlhood. The face under that thatch of yellow hair had changed almost unbelievably. It had not aged, but ripened. With its flushed cheeks, it reminded me of a wizened apple. Nice one there. So Walker argues that Untermeyer's description recalls the narrative of the aging starlet whose body, quote, eventually becomes the rejected toy of her audience. In a desperate attempt to regain her former glory, the aged star apes her own youth with grotesque and tragic results, and her attempts to prolong her girlhood only serve to undermine her former glamour and hasten her inevitable decline. However, I think that Walker's reading is a bit too simplistic here, particularly given that Millay's career success continued later in life. Her 1939 volume, Huntsman What Quarry, sold 60,000 copies within 1 month and was really a huge success, as were many of her later publications. She was still heavily photographed, taking place in a delightful photo shoot for Town and Country magazine in the 1940s. And I therefore want to end by proposing an alternative to this narrative of the waning star, that Millay was in fact actively playing with her image to the last, rather than constantly rewinding to her girlhood. In this sense, she can indeed be compared to Madonna, or as I like to think, Kate Bush with her recent triumphant return to the stage. But she can be compared to Madonna, not in terms of the tragedy of the aging starlet, but in terms of her amazing capacity for reinvention. In this talk alone, we have seen Millay transform from ethereal ingenue to bohemian flapper to inspired improvisatrice into the androgynous poet businesswoman of the 1930s. In the 1940s, Millay becomes the sage-like grand dame, reflecting her confirmed status as one of the most successful poets of the age. Consider, for example, Alfred Eisenstadt's 1941 portrait. A mature Millay gazes confidently at the camera, a knowing humour in her eyes and a smile playing on her lips. She looks witch-like and stately in her dark suit. And unlike in Genta's image, where she turns away from the camera, or the uneasy intimacy of some of Abbott's portraits, she looks relaxed and self-assured here. This image does not speak of the fading star, but of the confirmed doyenne of the poetry scene. And to conclude, another fascinating image of Millay arose from the 1942 photo shoot by New York's National Broadcasting Company, which was arranged to promote her dramatic poem, The Murder of Lydicey. The photograph shows Millay standing in front of a painting of a rather sardonic clown. This painting, A Pierrot by Walt Kuhn, was purchased by Millay in 1938, and she wrote to her lover, George Dillon, quote, "I have bought a painting by Walt Kuhn, one of the clown ones, a beauty, the terms being $1 million down and a ball and chain around my ankle for the rest of my life." Though Millay complains about the cost here, the painting was clearly a symbol of her wealth and status at this point in her career, of the fact she had $1 million to spend on art and had recently completed yet another successful reading tour. The prominence of the painting in this promotional photograph suggests that she was more than happy to show off this expensive purchase, and it actually appears in more than one image of her during this time period. But beyond being a symbol of Millay's success, I want to suggest that this painting provides an apt image for Millay herself, who stands in the foreground, looking comically stern and flicking through a sheaf of her poems. The clown looks out at us, the viewer, with a painted face and a silly hat, but weary eyes. This is the position of Millay vis-a-vis the photographic image, ready to play, to put on the mask and the makeup, but never quite falling for any of the artificial identities she adopts. Instead, Millay viewed such identities with an ironic detachment that enabled her to constantly reinvent her image. Millay was a chameleon who used her image flexibly throughout her career to play on and to subvert the expectations surrounding the poetess. She did this not only through her poetry and writings, but also through her photographic images, her dress, and her public performances. In doing so, Millay took active part in reinventing female poetic identity in the 20th century, and she goes on to influence numerous other poets, such as Anne Sexton and Adrienne Rich. Millay became an object through posing for the camera, but she controlled that performance from beyond the frame, playing with her identity to the last. Yeah, so if there's any questions, I'd be happy to...
I find your focusing on one aspect of Millay is really rather pathetic. I think you're guilty of wiggery. I think you're imposing the notion of 20th century, 21st century millennial ethics, whatever they are, on a woman who was born within 3 years before the end of the Victorian era. Sure, she was extremely promiscuous. Nothing, but none of the names were anything that she ever wrote. We know about this from other people, not from her. She was extremely, extremely, extremely a private person who did not wish things down. I mean, we know, she was a brilliant woman, a brilliant woman. She spoke five languages fluently, and she was the, did continue with many of the standards of previous ages. She was staunchly believed in standards. Well, I'm not, let me just finish. She staunchly believed in standards, so that while she was against the she was for promiscuity, she also believed in the strict standards of poetry, and this is why she despised the modern poets. My question is, how can you possibly explain, in your terms, that when Edmund Wilson came to her in the late 40s when she was destitute and asked her and with a contract for a very lucrative book, anthology of her poems, for which she was only asked to provide a sentence or two of background for the background of all of those poems, she categorically denied it, refused it, even though she was at the time destitute and needed the money? And why also did she publish all the time under the name of Nancy Boyd, when in fact she could have gotten three times the amount of money by publishing under her own name?
So as far as I understand it, your question is to do with her being a very private person and not wanting to spread information about her private life through a biographical or through using a pseudonym. Other than simply disputing that on the basis that I think you've profoundly misunderstood my argument here, I don't think there's really any way in which I can respond to that. But I agree that she was an intensely private person. I don't think that undermines many of the things I've said about the self-fashioning that she engaged in through photography and her public image. I think those two, being private but also performing her body and her image in that way, those two things don't have to be mutually exclusive. But does anyone else have any questions at all?
Well, she for a long time was sort of forgotten, and there's been this real resurgence. There have been a number of biographies in the last maybe 3 or 4 years. What do you attribute that to? I mean, she did have this period of time in the 50s, 60s, yeah, I would say, when no one read her.
Yeah, it also seems to have had little bubblings up over time, right? So that you'll find the odd article, you know, every few years, and I hope there's a resurgence, and I hope that I'm kind of part of that, or I feel like I'm kind of, you know, coming on the back of that. But one of the things I would say is to do with her not being a modernist or avant-garde poet in a time period that has very much, in terms of scholarly work, you know, it really has focused on the avant-garde, vers libre. So she's writing traditional poetry, and Suzanne Clark's book, Sentimental Modernism, attributes that really, you know, that's the reason that she's been forgotten, according to Clark, is that she's writing a kind of poetry that doesn't necessarily fit with modernist work that's being published around her at the time. Another thing I think is gender, and I think those two things interconnect. So you've got anthologies like The Gender of Modernism, and Millay doesn't make it into the anthology, whereas James Joyce does. You know, so in that time period in the 1990s, when a lot of female modernist writers are being, people are taking an interest in them, Millay gets forgotten again because she doesn't quite fit in with the modernism side. So I think those are two of the reasons. In the UK particularly as well, I think that she's just not as well known. So that's why I'm delighted to be here, you know, in the US, where people have actually heard of her and are enthusiastic about her.
So I'm just curious. I don't know what your like full project is, just because I haven't talked to you yet, but I was curious about like the sort of, right, we talked briefly about Halberstam and the sort of idea that she gets in her book about the self-fashioning of female masculinity in photography in very recent history. But then we also see it as far back as things like Queen Elizabeth fashioning herself as almost a military figure in her portraiture. So I was curious if like your project sort of ties her into a historical lineage of women who have played with this self-construction of, you know, clinging to femininity without, you know, sacrificing the masculinity, or switch those, but yeah.
Yeah, certainly I hope to. I mean, another figure that I'm looking at in my project is Charlotte Mew, who very much, well, on the one hand played with female masculinity, but then on the other also had a sort of, they describe it as the maiden auntish persona, or was self-consciously kind of playing up to being the sort of the quiet, shy spinster. But then also it kind of shades over into also, you know, she certainly wasn't emphasizing her femininity. So a lot of the figures I look at really are flexible enough to be able to know, you know, when to emphasize their femininity and when to attempt some kind of androgyny. And as I say, you know, there could be useful things about doing either of those, but I think a lot of the figures I'm looking at is it's their ability to move between those different categories that enables them to often reach a high level of fame or to, you know, increase their reputation through publicity. If you get stuck in one mold or another, then I think that that often works to your disadvantage. So I am interested in different manifestations of female masculinity, but it's more the flexibility of gender itself that I'm hoping to focus on.
I think we'll just stop there, but please join me in thanking Sarah.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.